Welcome to today's webinar, Creating a High Performance Organization Culture by Engaging Your Employees, part one of a two-part series featuring human resources, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. My name is Kara Fleury, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Susan Levine, Head of NA Private Equity, HR, and Talent Development at Bain Capital. Before we start, I have just a few reminders. Questions are welcome throughout today's webinar. Simply type them in the question area as you have them in real time. I will hold on to all questions until the speaker has finished the presentation. We will begin the Q&A session during the final 20 minutes of the call. Remember that no question is silly and every question is worth asking. Now is your chance to hear from an expert in the field. Please note that today's presentation will be recorded and made available to all registrants within 3 days on our YouTube channel, and I will also include it in my follow-up email. Finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the same question area. Without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and introduce our presenter. Susan is the head of NA Private Equity HR and Talent Development at Bain Capital. She is responsible for human capital management for the firm's investment and portfolio operations professionals. Her primary responsibilities include leadership and professional development, global recruiting, mentoring programs, resource allocation and culture, and connectivity programs for the private equity business. Ms. Levine also runs the firm's children's charity, Bain Capital Children's Charity. Over the past 20 years, the charity has raised and donated in excess of $50 million to hundreds of national charities, focused on everything from the arts to education to mentoring and providing a safe place to play. Ms. Levine graduated from Georgetown in 1989 with a BS in Spanish and went on to pursue an MA from the University of Pennsylvania's Annenberg School for Communication and an MBA from the Harvard Business School in 1998. She resides in Wellesley, Massachusetts with her husband, John, and 3 boys, Braden, who's 15, and twins, Ryan and Kyle, who are 13. In her free time, she loves spending time with her family, training for her annual Pan Mass Challenge bike ride, baking and cheering on her favorite Boston sports teams, the Celtics, Red Sox, and the Patriots. Susan, we're so excited to have you, and we're excited to get started, so I will go ahead and turn this over to you.
Thanks, Kara. It's so nice to spend so much time with my fellow Hoyas. So I'm excited to spend time talking today about a topic near and dear to my heart. And thanks so much, Kara, for giving a good plug for the Patriots and the sports teams up here. That certainly was fun. And when I think of high performance cultures and teams, I think we've certainly got a number of sports teams, the Patriots being one of them, up here. So thank you. I wanted to spend time, maybe the next 30 or 35 minutes with folks, talking a little bit about what we've been able to do at my company, not using external consultants, but using our own internal teams to think about this topic of culture and engagement. And just to start, when I think about culture, I really think that culture is the way that things get done in an organization and really reflects employees' behaviors and attitudes towards work. It's essentially what I call the secret sauce of an organization and bring a strategy to life, but it can also hurt a strategy if you don't have a good culture. I believe that culture is something that can be cultivated. I'm sure many of you, as I have joined teams, that perhaps the observation was the culture wasn't great. And when employees are engaged around topics, when there's a lot of energy, certainly from senior leadership, I think that over time, cultures can be cultivated in the direction that you'd like. I think employee engagement is really the willingness of employees to go that extra mile for the organization. And so often people go the extra mile, obviously, when the culture is great. And when they're very aligned with the values of the organization. So these things really go hand in hand, and I've definitely spent a lot of time in my current organization in an alternative asset firm really trying to define and shape a culture that is going to be a winning culture to help accelerate performance. So that's where we're going to spend a little bit of time today. We're going to talk about what do high-performance organizations look like, how to design what the topic of today is, a high-performance organization survey. And again, that would be utilizing your own resources right around you and not needing to spend a lot of money outsourcing to a provider, although you certainly can do that. But we tried to have this really be a grassroots effort in our organization for reasons that I'll describe. What can preliminary results look like if you actually do one of these surveys? And then what's next? We have a follow-up webinar in a couple of weeks talking about, you know, what do you do when you get all of the results. So just to start, I mean, clearly all of us want to be part of a premier firm and building a premier firm, and that really starts with many things. And do we have the right market opportunity? Yes. Do we have a sound strategy? Do we have a competitive advantage that seems to work? And clearly we're spending lots of time talking about all of those things, no matter what industry that we're all in. Today's competitive marketplace is tough, but having all of those things is really not enough. You actually got to execute it, and you have to have the culture to help you achieve that plan. And so I think we've all been in organizations where intuitively we feel like they are high performance organizations and people are ticking along and doing what they need to do. And often I've stepped back to say, well, how does that happen? In my own experience at my company here, there are certainly things when I joined, and I joined my company 11 years ago, where there were things that clearly I think we needed to change. And so it really takes an army and a village to align on what needs to change. But it all starts with the fact that for all of us, high-performance organizations lead with very strong teams. Our people are our assets, our engine, and our lifeblood. Our success is definitely driven by our ability to attract, retain, motivate, and develop the best team, no matter what industry. And that's really, that's really the most important thing. So what are those high performance behaviors, and what do they look like? As I just mentioned, I'm sure many of us have observed friends, colleagues who seem to work in cultures that feel like high performance cultures. You can definitely sense it. You can definitely see it. Instead of going through the motions, people seem really energized. They're confident about their organization's strategy and the changes that are occurring. They're not confused. They're not resigned. There are specific behaviors and actions that seem to take place. Many of those are listed here. There's high aspirations where good enough is not good enough. People never feel truly satisfied. People have a very external focus. They think like owners. People have a strong bias to action. I always say it's wonderful when in an organization people are doers and not talkers, and I'm sure we all want people to have that orientation. People who respect each other, never let someone down, and people who are open to change. And so those are pretty high-level, high-performance organization behaviors that we think about here in my company a lot, and they can be obviously tweaked for any organization. But a lot of what we're trying to do and a basis for starting is to think about what those behaviors are and why they're important in your organization. So how do you start thinking about creating this organization? One of the things that I was really struck with, and I've seen this particular survey and set of research for a number of years, is that when you think of organizations, most organizations, so 49% of organizations, when folks fill out organizational effectiveness surveys, will say things like, my organization, what we're doing here, our culture is sufficient for achieving reasonable success. And lots of people might think that's okay. But in today's world, we're all trying to outperform. And so really it's only 23% of companies. And this survey is done every year across a number of firms. And it really does not fluctuate from these percentages all that much. So only 23% of organizations feel that, people in organizations feel like my culture, my organization has a set of behaviors and principles that really allows our business to outperform. And so as a starting point, trying to think about how can I be one of those organizations and create a culture that's in the upper right-hand quadrant is at least where we've started in our journey. And it's pretty scary, you know, to actually think about, well, you know, designing an engagement survey design and asking people what they think about working at your particular company or in a division can be really scary. Lots of, and I got this reaction 7 or 8 years ago around why would you possibly want to ask people? I think they're, you know, 60% of the topics often can be reasonable topics to ask, but there's lots of topics that would be really, really scary to get the results. And so I do think a good place to start is to have the orientation that any topic should be a good topic to ask about, because you really can't make any change happen without actually getting the pulse on the organization. But I do love this this slide because, you know, you can't measure things unless you ask things, and you certainly can't make any progress unless you have an orientation top down from the most senior leadership that demonstrates to people that you really care, not only about asking, but about doing something about it after you do ask people and take the pulse on the organization. So in terms of the focus here, there's lots of characteristics of high performance organizations. I'll start with the second boxes are clarity and alignment around the strategy, people and performance, roles and structure, process and information. We're really going to spend our time on the culture aspect today. And it's definitely the foundation for all companies. Having a strong, cohesive culture, as I said, can help accelerate performance. But having behaviors inside an organization that are not helpful can certainly be quite derailing. So now we're going to talk a little bit about this notion of how do you think about if you really have a group of people, and I would start with the premise that it really should come from the most senior leadership is engaged in this topic. This is not an HR initiative, so to speak. So having, you know, understanding what it is versus what it is not when you're thinking about implementing a culture and engagement survey is important. It really is a holistic approach to building a world-class organization, especially if you are going to be committed to understanding the results, digging into the results, and developing an action plan to address some of the issues that that you see. It is not a set of diagnostic tools or a survey that has all kinds of quantitative metrics that people might look at. It really is the basis for starting a longer conversation, a multi-year conversation in some respects. I do believe that many of these issues cannot be solved within a year. They tend to be some low-hanging fruit issues, as we'll see. But there also don't be surprised if you have some issues that are very behavioral that and you might have to start a series of actions, a series of initiatives to address that particular topic. As I said, it's also not an HR initiative. It's really an agenda item, should be top of mind for the entire organization and the entire team. And I'll say this a couple more times today, but the best way to start here is for any senior leadership team to get up in front of the entire organization to say, this is really important, we're going to do this, and to have one or two or more members of that senior team on the team that's developing the survey and looking at the results. It's also not a one-size-fits-all approach. You know, this is a very specific tool that will be used if you survey your population, and we'll talk about the kinds of topics that you can address, but there's lots of other initiatives around leadership development, around coaching, other strategic principles and initiatives that will be going on around this happening. And you'll see over time, if you do this in a way where you're going to take a multi-year approach, many of these things need to be aligned. And sequencing many of these things is important as well. And so that may be a topic we want to discuss in the Q&A portion of this event. And then finally, as I said, it's not one time. If you're going to commit to doing this, doing it once allows you to really take the pulse on where the organization is. But doing it multiple times or taking a multi-year approach, we tend to do it every 18 months. And the cycle typically is we create a survey, we send a survey out, but coming out of that survey, there's multiple discussions and focus groups, and we develop an action plan. All of that can take a couple of months, and then it may take several more months to fix some of those issues. So for us, it seems that doing it every 12 to 18 months has seemed to make sense, but those are very, very good questions and high-level strategic questions that people should consider. So how do you think about designing the survey? Well, the first thing is, and every organization will be different, I'm giving you a snapshot of some of the things that one could have in a culture or engagement survey, but I certainly would not be restricted to this list. We take the pulse on firm strategy, on our culture overall, on our firm effectiveness, our team effectiveness, professional development, career path, and incentives and lifestyle. There are many other topics. I mean, this definitely is the bulk of our own internal organizational topics, but people can ask about specific strategies. You can ask about specific initiatives. There's multiple things that you could do. So that's really the basis to start here, is to think about what do you want to take a pulse on. I think some guidelines around that are helpful. Organizing an internal team to design the questions. Having senior leadership is important. You could have some HR people, some key business leaders and stakeholders. Typically a team of around 6 to 8, maybe up to 10 people, depending on how large your organization is, would make sense. But it really depends on the size and complexity of the organization. I put here skeptics are very welcome. I actually think one of the most important things in doing this, if you're going to do this internally, is to actually include people who are very skeptical about the process. We've had, I would say, around half the people on the initial team that we had several years ago as we started thinking about culture and engagement surveys be those people who are very skeptical about the process. And they can be your best sellers when you get the results, and they can be the people who can be strong advocates for the process going forward. So you really want to think about the people who are going to be on the team. Second, I think you want to solicit a lot of feedback before you try to decide what topics are good topics to potentially take the pulse on. You want to be transparent. You definitely don't want to hide or avoid topics that you know will be potentially controversial. People won't take this survey seriously if you avoid topics that you know are real issues in the organization. And so I'll just give you one example. In our particular organization, there was definitely a certain amount of hierarchy as there is at any organization. And hierarchy, I always talk about hierarchy as having a component of hierarchy is necessary and it's good hierarchy. What we were trying to weed out is bad hierarchy. And we talked about it a lot. If we didn't include questions about hierarchy and try to tease apart what's good versus what's bad in our initial surveys and our follow-up surveys, people wouldn't have taken the survey seriously. So you definitely want to be pretty all-inclusive around the topics that you care most about and the organization does. Another thing that I think is very important is keeping the survey completely anonymous. That will help when you ask a lot of open-ended questions, which I think are important. And we use SurveyMonkey as a tool to gather our results. It's very easy, and you are actually able to set up the survey in a way to make the responder totally anonymous. I think that that amount of anonymity definitely helps people be more honest in their survey results. And again, don't be afraid to get those results, because frankly, you've got to start somewhere, and you're only going to be able to make things better within your culture if you take an accurate pulse. And so
this can be a hotly contested topic, whether to make the survey anonymous or not anonymous. For us here, it has worked, but I could imagine a very lively debate around why to do that or why not to do that. And set a goal. And set a goal and have, this is where the senior leaders on the team can really be helpful by sending emails out to the organization. 70% of you have filled this out. We still have 30% to go. Again, it will be anonymous. You won't know who hasn't filled out the survey, but trying to have someone who is very respected and very senior in the organization show and demonstrate that it's critical and we want everyone's feedback is a way to get employees engaged. In terms of how you design the survey and what kind of responses you want people to get, you clearly have to use some kind of scale. There are 10-point scales, 5-point scales, 6-point scales. There are several scales out there, and there's different perspectives on the validity of some scales over others. If something works for your particular organization, you should continue using that. In our, here's a suggested approach, and one that I really like is a scale that doesn't allow you to be neutral. So in a 5-point scale or a 7-point scale, an odd-numbered scale, there's always a middle point. And the fear of having a lot of answers that are the middle point is someone's neither trying to be positive nor trying to be negative. So the reason why I like even-numbered scales, or here we use a 6-point scale, is you can see that people really have to decide which side they're on in terms of agreeing with a statement versus disagreeing. Clearly, you want people, as you think about it when they're filling out surveys, you really want everyone in your organization picking 4s and 5s, that they strongly agree or agree with a statement. We don't typically think that somewhat agree or somewhat disagree is good. It's probably more on the neutral scale, but it's certainly not what you aspire to have in an answer. And then obviously, strongly disagree and disagree is clearly bad and will highlight things that you will want to address. It's pretty easy, you know, if you have people that are engaged in the organization, either, again, from human resources or managers on teams, it's pretty easy to, once you take that pulse and you have your list of topics, to sit down and try to determine, and there are multiple online tools, actually, to figure this out. I'm also happy to share with anyone who's interested the particular survey that we use at my organization. But it's pretty easy to come up with very clear, very direct, short questions that don't lead the witness. So you don't want to lead someone to saying they strongly agree or strongly disagree. You want to be pretty direct and objective in the way you ask a question. So here's some examples for some questions we have in our firm strategy, which is, you know, my firm has a clear strategy and I believe in it. My firm is highly differentiated. I am clear on and understand how my firm creates value. I am clear on my firm's governance structure. So you're basically just trying to ask questions around whether people are engaged and motivated in their firm strategy. And there are many more questions we have in this particular section, but this just gives you an idea. I wanted to bring it to life a little bit. Similarly, on the culture side, these are the kinds of questions that we ask. And they're the typical ones that I could imagine everyone wanting to take a pulse on, whether the firm has a positive and motivating culture that inspires people to do great work every day. Ethical standards, taking the pulse on collaboration and teamwork, individual and team accountability, and the list goes on and on. This typically would emanate if your firm has a list of core values. These happen to be my firm's core values, many of the words that you see in this statement. So to the extent that your firm does have that kind of statement or value statement, that's where you'd want to take the pulse on. Do people buy into that? And are people do people understand what it is, and do they think, you know, there's a culture here that supports diversity, that supports having different points of view, that supports collaboration and teamwork? So if you have a value statement, this would be a great place to take the pulse on that. You know, in addition, I actually believe it's really important to ask open-ended questions. Not too many. That SurveyMonkey allows you to take in open-ended questions. So again, not too many, but a couple. Here's a list of ones that many organizations have used. We use some of these. What is the one change you'd most want to see coming from this effort? What would make you more effective in your role? What would make you happier and more satisfied? And what's something that we didn't ask but we should have asked? That last question is actually one of the most important questions that we tend to have in our surveys here. And you get very, very insightful data. The open-ended questions definitely require people to sit down and read all the comments. So you do have to be prepared for what's coming, because people are excited that the organization is asking them for their opinions and their views and perspectives. And many people tend to, you know, write quite detailed responses, which is great, but you just have to be prepared for the response. And then, of course, my favorite question, and if I were only had the resources or the ability to ask one question of my organization every year, I would ask what is called the Net Promoter Score, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with, which is basically just how likely is it that you would recommend us to a friend or recommend to a friend to work at my company? And many of you have seen this. It's for this particular question, it's a 1 to 10 scale, or a 0 to 10 scale is the appropriate scale, and you can actually change the scale in SurveyMonkey for that. And frankly, you want people who are going to answer 9s and 10s. Neutrals would be 7 to 8s, and detractors 0 to 6. This is a very insightful question that can be tracked and measured over time as well. And believe me, I think if you're on a multi-year journey asking people this question, everyone gets really excited. The organization gets energized when, from year to year, that number goes up. And I've also been involved in situations with different groups or different business units at my firm where that number goes down. And when the Net Promoter Score goes down from year to year, it can be a really catalyzing event for the organization, because people know that they're we're tracking it, it's important to them, and it can be a time where everyone will get together and get very energized around what to do around that. So very, very positive change can come from asking just this one question. I will keep going on if that's working for folks. So what can preliminary results highlight, and what do you do? So you've designed this survey, you've sent it out to your team. By the way, I should have mentioned, I recommend sending it to everyone and not discriminating. Send it to everyone in your organization. We send it to all of our administrative staff, our back office, finance and IT function staff, as well as our investment professionals here at the organization. That's another place where everyone can come together as one team. But what do you do when the results come in? And how should you communicate with your team? So the first thing is we always go out to everyone and tell everyone and thank everyone for taking the time to participate in the survey. You know, 100-question survey that we tend to send out, if you want to really be thoughtful about it, probably takes about 30 to 45 minutes to fill out, especially if you're going to be spending time on those open-ended questions. Give people a high-level view of what the positives were. So in this case, you know, we think people think we're a world-class firm. There were very high promoter scores. People tend to be happy. But then be honest. You know, despite high marks on some questions, there are definitely opportunities. All organizations have opportunities to improve. And the point of doing this survey is to determine how we can get better and how we can accelerate our performance. I always like to bucket our findings into very, because it can be overwhelming to look at results of 100 questions. And so what you're really trying to do, because you're trying to impact a lot of people and influence a lot of people on the results, is really try to bucket them and say, there are a number of places where people agree we have areas of excellence. And let's celebrate those. And let's talk about them. And let's rally around them. Secondly, there are a number of places where we have opportunities and we need to talk about. We need to have further conversation about. And third, there are specific groups or specific what I call hotspots impacting maybe a well-defined group. You have the ability in the survey to look across the entire organization and see what are those areas of strength that everyone is aligned on, which would be the first bucket. Same with the second bucket, those opportunities that are everyone agrees that there's one or two or five specific things we should tackle. But there may be a specific group, junior population, senior population, your IT or administrative population, that has a hotspot. And they're the only ones. Maybe for everyone else, it's that particular dimension or those questions are positive, but for that group of people, there's an issue. Well, you'll want to delve into that. And we typically do some targeted focus groups with that team that you've developed to design this survey and execute this survey. That team will then be responsible for going out and doing some focus groups. And you can do focus groups in a number of different ways, but focus groups work best when they're smaller by level. Are the leaders of the focus groups are people you know will be able to elicit responses and really good conversation. So sometimes you'll want to add some people who are very well respected within a group or across the organization to help you lead those groups. The idea is to really get people talking, that you see the quantitative results, but you really want to get people talking about what these issues mean to them, what are specific examples and places where the issue has impacted them, and maybe some preliminary ideas on what folks can do to improve. So I'm going to take you through right now just to give you an idea for what some of these results can look like. And then, you know, we'll end by talking a little bit about the focus groups and action plan and where do you take it from here. But I thought it would be helpful just to show you, okay, what are you actually going to get from the survey? For that most important question, and the one that we always track and keep up on our water cooler and important places in the organization is that Net Promoter Score. We do it by looking at different departments, different business units, different levels. Here, just to show you, clearly, in this example, our Net Promoter Scores were pretty high between two groups of people on the left-hand side, but there definitely was, by title, a group of people that probably seemed to be less enthusiastic than the rest of the group. And so that's where you want to try to get down to that granular level of detail by understanding the results and segmenting the results so you can start targeting specific groups of people. There are, in that category of what does everyone agree and where can we have alignment around our areas of strength, this can be really empowering to a team. Often we're so busy about doing our day jobs and trying to work and collaborate across different organizations, different teams, but we don't all work together. And everyone works, I'm sure, really hard where you are. And one of the things that I found most powerful about doing this survey over a number of years is that when you show people where you scored the highest, and where people were aligned on areas of strength, it's very empowering. And people start walking around saying, isn't this great that we feel like we are a strong team and everyone understands our strategy and whatnot. So I think that it's not self-serving in the sense that, you know, there may be areas that you know you're going to score very high on, but across a number of questions, it can be very powerful to look at those places. You know, for example, I'm proud to be part of this firm. That's a really important question, and you know, you definitely want to see more. The more dark green you have, the better. You definitely don't want the yellows and the reds in here. But tracking this over time to make sure that people are really proud in the firm is important. Those open-ended questions that I talked about can be really powerful, and this is one of our favorite types of things to do with the surveys to create some word clouds. One of the questions we ask is, What would you tell a recruit are three strengths of our organization? And similarly, we ask, what would you tell a recruit are three weaknesses? And so people will obviously type in words like tenacious and creative and smart and so on and so forth. But no one really takes the time, you know, to go take a pulse on the entire organization unless you do something like this, and you take those results and you throw it into a word cloud, and it can be very powerful to for people to see what alignment there is on where your strengths are. Similarly, as I said, and I didn't include in here, but I'm happy to share with people, those places where people see opportunities can also be very enlightening. And sometimes there's a disconnect between the most junior people on the team or another pocket of the organization and the most senior people. And we've all heard that. And so really leveling the playing field and having everyone see the results from the most senior to the most junior on the team is very powerful. And this can also help, by the way, with either refining or developing values and behaviors to the extent that your organization does not have them. So seeing some of those things is really powerful. So this just kind of gives you more thoughts on what you're going to get as results on your firm strategy. Some of the questions that I had at the beginning around firm strategy and performance are captured in here. Singular items that from a culture perspective that scored highest. So out of 100 questions, these might have been, some of the highest scoring questions. We have strong ethical standards. People feel very accepted. Our culture fosters teamwork and collaboration. There's some yellow and there's some red, but across the board, when you're taking a large organization like this, seeing those first two shades of green, which is essentially the top two numbers on a rating scale, is really powerful. But it's also really powerful to see where perhaps people don't feel like you're doing a great job. And this helps you drive an action plan coming out of doing a survey. So in this particular example, this is from a survey that we had done probably 7 years ago, 8 years ago, and we've made progress on a number of these items. So one of the first ones, which I always find fascinating, is people were not clear on our firm's governance structure. So again, lots of senior people walking around feeling like they understand the governance structure, but the rest of our team did not understand the governance structure. That turned into a series of conversations with the organization and town hall meetings to make sure that everyone understood it. It was very simple to implement, but we didn't know this unless we had asked, unless we had asked the question. And so some of these things are low-hanging fruit things that you can definitely go out and solve pretty easily. Other things, like the last two, our two main groups in the organization act like one integrated team, and the culture encourages people to voice their consent. Those were things that were more behavioral, and we really needed to do a number of follow-up focus groups and have a number of conversations with senior leadership all the way down to junior people to understand what was going on. And in our next webinar series, we'll talk more about what specifically you can do when you see the results and you see that clearly there are some problems and issues, because it's very hard just looking at the quantitative results to know where to go. And similarly, as I mentioned, sometimes you'll see results where with one specific group, that group is not happy. So I'm fairly compensated. People always laugh, why would you possibly ask people if they're happy with their compensation? But it's important. Clearly, all HR teams do a lot of compensation benchmarking, but sometimes there may be a correct or an incorrect perception, or correct or incorrect facts, and that can lead to making sure you're taking the pulse on that particular group of people. So this is what I would define as a hotspot. This was a particular hotspot in our organization with our principals and our VPs. And you may get other hotspots in other places that don't tend to be as elevated an issue with other groups, but do tend to be very elevated with one specific group. So you'll want to definitely take note of what those are. So where are we? I mean, I think, one of the most important parts of all of this, that every time we do a culture and engagement survey at our organization, we get multiple emails from people saying, clearly I may not be happy, or I may not be as engaged in certain topics, but the fact that you're asking us and the fact that you're taking the pulse and you're going to do follow-up focus groups and you're going to develop an action plan is amazing. And so that's one of the main thoughts that I would leave you with today. It can be scary to do this, but it definitely leads to employee action and employee engagement, especially if you're going to commit to spending more time on focus groups with the team, developing an action plan of top initiatives to pursue, ensuring employees play a lead role, at least a support role, and many of those actions. So I'll give you an example. One of the things that was most frustrating to our junior people here was a number of issues around our IT and the speed of our computer systems and other devices that we had. And so we actually designed a group of people that included junior associates and vice presidents on a team that lasted for about a year. And they have been, for the past 5 years, most of them are still at the organization, advocates for what we're doing. They continue to take the pulse on the organization. They do a special IT survey every year. And that can be really empowering to people. And then finally, you have to communicate progress to the organization, good and bad progress, but it's important to make sure that you keep the pulse on the organization and you let them know what you're doing. I think on March 23rd, we have the second part of this webinar series, and we'll delve into a number of those topics. Today, I think we wanted to talk about the survey and why you would do it, some high-level thoughts on how to design it, and then how do you share the results with the team. I think the last thing that I'll leave you with is, for many organizations and for us here, this has been, as I said, a multi-year effort. And we've done many more, we've had many more initiatives than what you can see here, but it's really fun to track what you've done over time. And so if you do have that philosophy that this is the start of our, taking the pulse on the organization, and you track it, you communicate, you report out on it, it creates a lot of engagement. And so I would encourage you to make sure you're not just thinking about surveys in the year that you do them, but really trying to take that pulse over time and share with people, even if they're new to the organization, all the great work that people have done. So I will stop there. I know we have some time, maybe about 15 or 20 minutes for questions. I'm very happy to speak with anyone offline if people want to have follow-up questions or would like to see the particular survey that we actually send out to spark your creative juices. But thank you for your time today. I'm delighted to do this for my fellow Hoyas, and I'd like to take any questions that people might have.
Susan, thank you so much. The presentation was fantastic. We already have quite a few questions coming in. And as a reminder to everyone on the line, if we are not able to get to your question, as Susan mentioned, please feel free to reach out to her directly. We may even have some of those addressed in part two of this webinar on the 23rd of March. So Susan, I'll go ahead and get started with the first question, which is, in creating these surveys, and just thinking about the amount of work that goes into it, how many people do you typically recommend being a part of that team in writing the survey? Would be part one of the question. And then the second part would be, how long does it typically take?
And how long does it take to do the survey? Sure. So I think, this goes back to really starting with a team of thinking about what are the objectives, and going back to that slide on what do you want to take the pulse on. I do recommend, if this is the first time you're going to do it, trying to be as broad as possible. And, no topic is a taboo topic, and ask a number of questions. You know your organization's best. I would say that, for many folks, many surveys that I've seen are 200 questions long. I always felt that was just going to be overkill. And we set as a rule here, those simple direct questions and maybe 10 categories to try to keep it to about 100 questions max with a couple open-ended questions. So that's the target that we're shooting for. But I certainly have advised and worked with some of our portfolio companies where they'll say, I can't do more than 50 questions. And so, you'll definitely get it down and get it down to the point where you feel like there will be an appetite for people to answer the questions. In terms of the number of people, I really recommend a very small group of people designing the survey. You don't want to have a lot of cooks in the kitchen. You want to solicit a lot of feedback. You want to have a team of people, however you want to design that team. Again, I would have a sponsor of this effort who's a not necessarily an HR person, but a senior leader in the business as part of that team to set the tone. But I can tell you from my perspective that here we've typically had a small group of 2 to 3 people. It really came down to like one person owning about 80% of writing the survey, and then a lot of iteration back and forth to make sure we had it correct, and sharing it with the broader committee, the culture and engagement committee that we have here, to make sure those questions were correct. How long? I would say it takes the survey itself probably takes about 30 minutes to 45 minutes, as I said, if there are a number of questions. There's probably one other element to the how long, which is just you've got to design the questions, then get it in SurveyMonkey and do a little bit of testing. That whole process can take, about a week, not a week 100%, but you'll just want to make sure if someone gets the survey in SurveyMonkey, and then there's a little bit of testing to make sure it's going to be anonymous and you get the results the way you want to get the results. So hopefully that answers that question.
Yes, excellent. Thank you, Susan. The next question has to do with asking in the survey things that you know you are unable to change. How do you address those things in the survey without raising unrealistic expectations?
Things that you are unable to change?
Yes, correct.
Yeah. So that's a great, I think there are concrete things, and then there are behavioral things, is the way I would separate them. If there are very concrete structures or things you cannot change, frankly, I wouldn't ask about it, because that might come up in a focus group. But if it's something about the way a team is designed or the process that a team has to follow, and senior leadership is very focused and does not think there can be any change to that, that might be a topic that it probably will come up in the focus groups as, and it might be something that comes up as, why didn't you ask me this question? But that's where you're gonna get a lot of color in the focus groups around, we hate this process, or this process is, takes a lot of time. And the response will be, and that has happened with us, the response will typically be that a senior leader coming out to the organization, and we did several town hall formats after the results came in and after our focus group, saying, we heard you. There are a number of things we possibly can't change, but let's just make sure everyone understands the rationale and the business reasons why we can't change them. So some of those things that are impossible to change at all, I might not put in the survey. But there might only be like a few topics or a few issues that you really can't change. I think that anything around culture, around cultural behaviors can be changed. They may be very, very hard to change, but I do think they can be changed. And so asking people, we had a question around, do you feel comfortable, speaking up, or, do you feel comfortable challenging the status quo? That may be within your organization something you really don't want, let's say, junior people to, to speak in certain meetings. But, I wouldn't be afraid to ask a question about that, because there can be other issues going on and other problematic behaviors that might stem from that. So just to summarize, I think anything behavioral, I still would ask. I think if there's something structural that you absolutely can't change, I likely would not include it in the survey, but if it comes up in focus groups as a hot topic, and why didn't you ask this, that would be a perfect place for someone to address with the whole team, the whole organization. Let's just kind of remind everyone why we can't do that.
Thank you, Susan. Yes, wonderful. This next question has to do with startups. Do you have any advice for startups that are thinking about how to build that positive and productive culture from the ground up with each hire? So any recommendations you have for very small companies that have a less formal structure?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. That, you know, Kara, that might be a great topic for another webinar, which I'd be happy to talk about. I think with very, and we have business units, so maybe this is the best way I can address this. We have business units here at my company that have only 10 people. And so, and we still, we don't do a 100-question survey, but we do want to create that culture, as you're saying, with very high-performance behaviors. One of the things that we've done is taken some of the material around what are those behaviors, right? Some of the slides that were in the earlier part of this presentation, and what are winning behaviors. And so one of the things we've done with some of our smaller business units is, you know, we've had a offsite or, you know, one day or a series of quarterly offsites where we wanted to talk about setting the tone for the organization and making sure we were defining a culture of success. And that was probably, I think we, you know, using that terminology of defining a culture of success or defining, you know, a high performance organization behaviors and how can we subscribe to those. I think clearly, you know, it's going to be hard when people are in startup mode and there's only 10 people or maybe even 5 people at an organization to do something like this. But I think you know what they are, you know what they look like, going back to what I said very early on. And I think, and I'd be happy to share with the person who asked that question, some of these materials that we've used with some of our smaller business units around those conversations with the team, because it could be just a half-day offsite where you get together and everyone says, these are the norms and behaviors that we want to establish from the get-go. So we want to be honest with everyone. We want to be transparent. We want to be collaborative. You know, those are the kinds of things that people should talk about, and I think good practice for startups would be to do that to the extent there's time. So I do think it's different, you know, and I don't think you need to, you can do a survey like this, even if it's 25, 50 questions or 100 questions, but I agree with you, probably in the first 2 years, it's hard to do that. It's more a conversation-based discussion around what's the kind of culture we want to define, which is really important to do, you know, when you're a small team.
Susan, we have a question that has to do with larger companies now. And we have an alum on the line who is actually about to start working on a cultural transformation exercise in his rather large tech company. The problem seems to be, or a possible challenge, is that the leader may not necessarily buy in. How should they go about convincing him of the survey? And the other question is, you know, should they try and quantify the benefits at all?
Yes, that's a great question. And I've spoken to so many colleagues over the years who have done this in large, medium, small companies. And I would say that a critical success factor is to have someone on the senior team have that buy-in. You need that buy-in and support. That helps validate the success. If people look up at that leader who is a very, you know, a leader who's, you know, very respected in the organization, is setting the tone for the strategy, but doesn't see that that person has a lot of buy-in, it can be really tricky. And people, you know, may not take it as seriously as they would like. However, you know, I'm sure this being a large company, there are several people on the senior leadership team. We had a situation here, frankly, where one of our most senior folks on the team, not the person running our business, was absolutely a massive, massive skeptic. And it definitely took him a full year to get through the survey and see the action plan coming out of it and see the excitement that people had and, once we reported out on progress of initiatives, for him to turn around. And I would say for the last, you know, 6 or 7 years, he's completely bought into it. So I get that there may be this, you know, the one leader may not be bought in. I think it's important to try to get that person bought in or try to figure out, are there others on the senior team who can influence that individual? Sharing some of the results and some of these are, you know, publicly available for tech companies and others on what what a culture of engagement does to help accelerate performance if that person tends to be a more analytical person and less a, you know, what some people will say is this warm and fuzzy. It's really not warm and fuzzy. It really is like if you don't have the right culture, it's hard to accelerate performance. And so I think if this person tends to be more analytical, one of the things that I try to do early on with those kinds of people is share, you know, some of those results to, you know, some of that kind of research-based results to get those people to buy in. But it can definitely be tricky, I would think, and I'd be, you know, happy to talk about brainstorming, how to get those skeptics on board. But I do think it's important to not make this an initiative that's just, you know, coming out of one group or HR, but that this is, there is that buy-in. And, but there's ways to do that depending on who this person is and what the natural orientation of the person is.
This has to do with core values of an organization. And as we know, they are a cornerstone. Can the survey also challenge whether those core values are still relevant?
That's a great question. That's a fantastic question. So I, coming out of our first survey that we did several years ago, we didn't have a core values statement. The work that came out of our first survey for our organization highlighted the fact that we needed those core values. And there were so many things that we were aligned on, but also people would really be empowered and engaged if we had a core value statement. So we went off for a couple of years to develop that core value statement. Most recently, a year ago, to get to your question, we took the pulse on in our survey. Do you believe in those? Do you think the organization lives by them? Which ones do you think we're really good on? And which ones do you think are the most challenging for us? And what came out of that was that, you know, there were two places where we felt like we needed to do a little bit more work, but also what came out of that particular piece of analysis is there may be something that you didn't have in your core value statement. And so, you know, for us, one of the things that we added based on that was, you know, I think generally they were right, but we really wanted to take the pulse and we made a few tweaks. But one of the things that we didn't have in there is, you know, in my particular company, people are tend to be very passionate about supporting each other and their, you know, personal interests and motivations. And so we actually wove that in to our core value statement because it was such a prominent theme within our culture. So yes, you can absolutely, if you have something, you can ask about it and you can measure whether people like it or don't like it and whether there needs to be change. And when you get the quantitative results and you see some are higher than others, going into focus groups, if that's a priority for the leadership team, you can say, let's talk about these values and whether they're working or not. And you're going to get a lot of rich culture, as we'll talk about at the end of March, from those focus groups. Kara?